This is part two of the Greater Creator series, where I talk about people who I think are greater creators. First, we're gonna start with Eric's Every New Day. He's been making videos for the last 5 years where he shares his own self-image, and it's really interesting because Eric's self-image videos have inspired a ton of other people to make their own, and that's where I found a lot of other great YouTubers.
I'm a humanist, a feminist, and a believer in good peopleist. I'm a Clevelander, a vegetarian, a runner, and a gamer. I'm Eric, and it's 2014. Really quickly, I encourage all of you to make self-image videos, but there are no more video responses on YouTube, so you can, in the comments, link videos now. So please go down there and link any self-image videos you want and tell your friends if they make a video to link them in the comments of this video so that everyone can come to this place and find all of the self-image videos very easily.
He also gives pretty good advice and he'll make you laugh while he's giving it.
A lot of people are making videos on what it's like to go to university for the first time, so I thought, since I spent a fifth of my life there, I'd do that. Don't wear a f***ing lanyard. That's it. That's the only advice you actually need. There'll be more, but that's all you need. Join a club. There'll probably be a big event the second week where all the clubs show up and they're all just clubbing around, like some techno music drops, and everyone just starts dancing. They start clubbing it up. That's all the advice I have for you guys about college. See you later.
I may also have a little bit of beard envy.
My beard makes me feel pretty. It makes me feel more attractive. It doesn't make me feel all that masculine, which a lot of people assume is what it is, because I've never really identified as all that masculine. It makes me feel good about myself and my appearance, though. And I find it kind of funny that people are willing to just say about my beard that they don't really like it all that much, because I would never say something like that to a girl about her hair or something along those lines. I would never be like, your hair's not looking very good today, because that's really mean and hurtful. If you like something and it makes you feel better as a person and more attractive, you should embrace that and you shouldn't take the shit from people that are against that for almost no real reason.
Next up, we have Luke David Sims. He's very poetic and demonstrative.
I think what I'm trying to say is that you should feel regret for your mistakes, because it means you know you fucked up. It means you know you've done wrong. It means you know you can do or be better. That feeling isn't there to make you hate yourself. It's there so you can learn from it, so you can turn a negative into a positive. So I put my figurative blood, sweat, and tears into this, and once it's done, I'm left with something I'm so proud of. This beautiful little loaf of bread. It's small, but I put my love, my time, energy into this. And I slice it up, and five people try it. Each of them look at me, and they smile. I really enjoyed this, they say. I can't wait until you make another one. The next day I go to a supermarket, and I go down an aisle, and I pause. There's a little loaf of bread. Maybe it looks a lot like mine. Maybe it doesn't. But these loaves. Thousands upon thousands of people eat these loaves. Now, am I meant to feel jealous here? Am I meant to feel sad or bitter, maybe? Am I meant to feel discouraged? Am I meant to feel worse about what I made? I mean, only five people ate my bread. But thousands of people eat theirs. I've let the worth of the dough be measured by the number of people that eat the bread. And is something's worth determined by the number of people that consume it? No. No, I don't think it is.
Next is Greg Poblet, or Poblete, I don't know how to say his name. What I like about Greg's channel is that he just has fun with whatever he does, and he isn't afraid to try new things.
Adventure time, come on, grab your friends, and go to very distant lands with Jake the dog and Finn the human. Fun will ever end. Jake, he's a dog-like stretch, and not being far-fetched when I say he's the best bet. Finn, he wears a pretty cool hat, and carries a sword and a green backpack. Princess Bubblegum, I'd say she's pretty neat, and I literally mean it when I say she's sweet. Ice King, he lives in the cold, and his beard makes him look really, really old.
I see a massive root through the trees. I see a salty message written in the east. The ground beneath my feet, the hot garbage and concrete. Tops of buildings, I can see them too.
He also has an annual video series, sort of like Eric's self-image videos, called VidCon High Fives. Greg's been collecting high fives from the people he meets at VidCon for the past 4 years. And seeing as I've never met Greg in person, one of my goals for next year's VidCon is to meet Greg, give him a high five, and be a part of VidCon High Fives, because that would be cool.
Pop it, like we really should. I'm up on your mind, feeling pretty good. Don't stop it. Bitch, you in my way. Thank you so much. Oh, wow, okay.
I feel like I can't properly introduce Mike Falzone, but I'm gonna try anyways. He is hilarious and will give you the best advice you've ever gotten in your entire life at the same time. And I'm just gonna let him speak for himself.
If I put out a video and it gets a million views, I promise I will be just as proud of it as if it gets one view. Because that means that one person, at least, took time out of their life that they will never get back to spend it with me on something that I made for both of us. Not once have I ever been discouraged or let down by the number of views or lack thereof on any of my videos. You know why? Because I'm happy to be alive. I think my videos have exactly as many views as they're supposed to, and I'm lucky to have each and every one of them. I'm proud of everything I make, and I'm grateful to everyone who happens to find it. So what am I trying to say? No matter what you do, believe in it and keep doing it. Be proud of it. Be proud of yourself for doing it. Point is, don't always let a number that you think is supposed to mean something else dictate what you do with your life. Invisible barriers are the least dope. That would make a good regrettable tattoo. If you want to do something, all you have to do is work as hard as you possibly can to be the best version of that thing that your body and mind will allow. And again, with the squinting windiness. And if you realize that your life plan isn't working out exactly the way you thought it would, it's probably because you were young and stupid when you made the plan. The mark of a genius isn't measured by the time that you spend on the top, but how you got there. Find out what you need to do to be the very best you, and then do that. And that doesn't come to you overnight. Feel free to breathe on it for a little bit. And especially, do all of that regardless of how old you are. The amount of hope that you can give yourself by getting rid of unnecessary limitations is scary awesome. You just have to want to work.
So I asked Joe, Mr. Guitar Man, if he was addicted to the idea of challenging himself. And he said yes, not surprisingly. And then he went on to say, well, I just get bored. And then the way I get out of that is I challenge myself. So I'm gonna go ahead and say that challenging yourself is officially the cure to being bored. I've heard some people say that only boring people get bored, and I don't think that's true at all. You're bored when you get stuck. I guess it's just a matter of how bad you want to get yourself unstuck. Imagine if you could actually be addicted to challenging yourself. How funny would those rehab meetings be? Hey, what's up? My name is Mike. I've been addicted to challenging myself for about 12 years now. And I'm sorry, do you guys think I could lift this couch? You could take comfort in the fact that as long as you have the desire to challenge yourself, you're gonna be better than you were yesterday. Even if you fail at something you're trying to do, you could take comfort in the fact that you're consistently testing your boundaries and expanding your skill set by default. I guess the moral of the story is just don't become complacent. You could always be better, and more importantly, you're gonna learn a lot about yourself while you're at it.
Next we have It's-a-Me Mylio. He has one of the most unique styles out of any YouTuber I've ever watched. His videos are all over the place in the best possible way. You never really know what you're going to get or how you're going to get it. You do know that his fast pace is entertaining and it will keep your attention and it will make you think a lot.
I hate feeling stagnant and not doing anything creative just makes me feel useless. And you get in this cycle about being annoyed that you're annoyed and being disappointed that you're disappointed. And you try to edit videos and you just think, what's happening? Editing is like reverse therapy.
And I think it's because I don't have a creative process that I can just go to. I don't know what my creative process is. At the minute, my creative process is mostly just waiting. Waiting and hoping. What was Van Gogh's creative pro? I mean, he was probably not the best person to look at. He chopped off his ear.
The BBC was up in Manchester, so I felt right at home. As a man.
18 years and I've never been on a tram.
Damn, it feels good to be a gangster.
That's pretty good. New experiences. The BBC may be serious about fun. I'm fun about fun. Doesn't really make sense. The BBC's an interesting place. The buildings are expressing emotion, and that one's teaching me how to vlog. I'm pressing the button. It just keeps stopping.
I think one of the strangest things that's happened to me recently, no, not that.
That's brilliant.
Is I was in London recently with my friend Ryan, and we both looked up into this window and just said out loud, there's balloons up there. There's balloons in that window. Why are there balloons in that window? That's a lot of balloons. I've never seen that amount of balloons in a window before. What is going on? And then, still looking at the balloons, we both just said,
look at that room.
I wonder if we can get up there.
You just dribbled.
No.
Out of excitement.
Look at my hair. I look like a little wombat.
What is going on? What are we doing? We just looked up. There were balloons in a room, and now we're in that room.
This is like the weirdest thing ever.
In between two pioneering shops of the future sat the 3D printing studio. I stepped into this big room. I was faced with 64 cameras, like a photo bomber's wet dream. I then stood here, did a stupid face, and went straight into the computer, like Tron.
I think that's a lot better.
Classic Mario's face.
Here's the actual technology happening, with my figure appearing like a ghost, and then rising from the powder like a dusty phoenix. Also, in the future, I'm going to show my kids this and say, that's how Daddy was made. I find 3D printing really fascinating because not only is it a new technology, but in this form, it's a different way to sort of capture the moment. When I look through photo albums of old black and white photos of my grandparents, I know it happened, but it doesn't seem real. It's like it's trapped behind the photo frame, this sort of window of time. And I'm not saying that 3D models are going to replace this type of photography, because obviously that's a stupid thing to say. I just think that they can live quite happily next to each other, specific special moments captured in 3D, like a wedding day, and you can see exactly how the dress hung from all angles. And for somebody who makes YouTube videos for the money, memory, it just sort of strikes a chord for me.
Okay, that is part two. Let me know if you liked any of these people, if you already heard of them, if you hadn't heard of them, but liked them. I hope you enjoyed their videos, and I'll see you next week.